You're welcome to sing. Here we go. In loving kindness Jesus came, my soul in mercy to reclaim, and from the depths of sin and shame, through grace he lifted me. He called me long before I heard, before my sinful heart was stirred. But when I took him at his word, forgive me, lifted me. From sinking sand he lifted me, with tender hands.
What an awesome morning, celebrating 75 years. Thank each and every person that was involved in putting this together. Glad to see each and every one of you here. If you're a guest this morning or you haven't been here for a while, please take out your connection card and fill that out for us so that we'll have a record of you being here. There's some information on the back of some opportunities. Also, just want to mention there's a paper in your worship folder for some poinsettias, if you would like to help with that at Christmas. And make sure you read your worship folder. There's a lot of information in there that would be beneficial through the week. We thank you for being here. I know some folks have traveled from far to town, and appreciate each and every one of you. Can't talk this morning. Let's pray and we'll worship. Father, we just thank you for bringing us together this morning. Thank you for each and every person participating in the worship. And we just thank you, Lord, that we can open up our minds and our hearts to you and give back to you on this day. And Father, we just thank you for the 75 years that you've given us, given this church here on this corner. And we just pray, and our wish is for 75 more years or longer, that this church will be a lighthouse on the corner here in Hickory. Father, we just thank you for loving us. And we ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
All right, please stand with us. And I just want to, you guys might notice a new somebody up on stage with us. This is Rodney. He, if you don't know him, yes. For those of you that don't know him, he used to be the worship leader here. So he brought me in as a singing on worship team. So it's really nice to have him up here. And I just want to say that you're going to see a lot of people singing solos today. That doesn't mean you guys don't sing. There's going to be words up there, and I want everybody to sing everything with us. So let's go ahead and worship together.
Before we have the ushers come, we'd like to have Ms. Donna Klein come and make some presentations and recognize some guests. You need a handheld, don't you? Yes, you do, sister. Whether or not you want one, here you are. Here you are, yes.
Good morning. Well, this is an honor, and I have some guests. Everybody knows me, knows I don't lock this. Okay, I gotta laugh or I'll cry. So. Okay. There's several guests that could not come. V.C. Martin, who was the reverend here in 1945 these glasses don't work. Okay, 1945 to December 1963. And his daughter was going to come, and she was so excited, but she's got the shingles. So I told her, we invited her to come whenever she's well, and we'll recognize her then. Is it Connie Robinson too?
Brother Ernie, are you in the building? Ernie, or is Ernie Robinson in the building?
Okay,
I don't see. How about Ernie's mother? Is Mrs. Robinson in here? Okay.
Okay. That couldn't come. And then I invited Reverend Byrd's grandson, and he wasn't able to come. But we have some great guests here. I would like to recognize Homer Green, who has been here, a pastor since... came in March of 1972, and he still is a pastor at heart. It's always available. And then the next one I would like to introduce is Rodney Poe, Reverend Poe. He came in 2000, and he left us in 2014, but we will never let him leave. Okay. Right. And so, is Ken Case here? He is? Oh, yes. Well, Ken was a youth pastor in 2005, and then started Reflection, which is part of Sandy Ridge Baptist Church. He helped start it. And Brian Holloway is
here. Hey, Brian.
Say it one more time.
Brian Holloway. He was our children's pastor from 2008 to 2010, I believe. Then we'd like to recognize a lady that has really been a support for this church, and is Miss Tammy Davis. And she... came to us in 2006. And she's still here. Thank you. Yes. And we would like to give a special recognition to our staff here that we love dearly. Pastor Sturm, Reverend Sturm. Yeah, Reverend Sturm. Yes, yeah, and he's not leaving either, so.
You guys should just stay standing.
It's just funny.
We'd like to recognize Zach Smith, who is our youth pastor. And John Moore, but he's over there with our children, so we'll catch up with him later. And we also want to recognize Miss Angie, who has helped us so much. Music. And we're glad everybody came. All the new people that I haven't seen in a long time, I hope I get to get out there and see you. It's hard to see. All right.
Thank you so much.
We'll have you come back up here in just a moment yes. All right, I'd like to ask, is Michael Franklin in the room? Where are you at, Michael? Thank you, please stand. Michael, and then Dwayne and Renee Frost, would you stand, please? These three people are coming before Sandy Ridge Baptist Church to present themselves for church membership. They have all completed Starting Point. They have all professed to be born again through faith alone in the blood of Jesus. They've all professed to be immersed in water since belief, and they have prayed about this decision to join Sandy Ridge Baptist Church, and we'll vote on them at the next business meeting. Thank you. Maybe see you. Zach Baumgartner, would you stand and introduce your guest, or is she out of the office? We'll give you another chance in a little while. I understand there's a new household member. No? Okay. She knew preaching was coming up, and she's like, forget that. I'm out of here. Good. Next time. All right. And we just want to give a shout-out to Eli Evans, who's 72 years old today. And if you know Dick Hoke, do you know Richard Hoke? He's our oldest member, and he turned 94 today. And he's, you know. I'd like to offer congratulations, which you normally do, to folks that have reached a milestone in their commitment to one another in marriage. And so congratulations to Dave and Donna Houston, reaching 50 years of marriage this week. And we'd like to wish a happy 24 hours to Jacob and Robin Church. May there be many more hours. Amen. Yes. Praise the Lord. All right. All right, let's do that again. Donna, come on up here and show us what else you want to present before us. I think you need your team to do this one, don't you? All right. I want to give thanks to the Lord for our 75th anniversary committee who planned this day. I praise the Lord for them, and you're seeing them right here in front of you. Michael Franklin took the place of his mother on the committee, and we praise God for what Annette Franklin meant and means to this church, don't we? Amen.
Annette told me that she found out that the 50th committee challenged the 75th committee, which was us, to make a quilt. And so, this is one of Annette's, she wanted this so bad. So we want to dedicate this to her today. Amen. So, and most of it on this quilt is our church today.
Say all that again, it's hard to hear.
Oh, okay.
Go ahead, say it again.
Okay. We tried to make this quilt what our church is today, what all the missions and everything that we do at Sandy Ridge and the people.
So there's pictures on there of different scenes and different groups within our church. So we'll have this on display. Brother Ray Pruitt has agreed to put glass on it for us, and we'll have it on display just like the last one. And there's pictures of our church at different stages of our construction and different groups. No, sister, I wanted to just help you along a little bit there. What else? What's in the middle there?
The church.
Yes. I think you're right.
I think I am. And our pastors and their families.
Yeah.
It's just everything.
It's everything. Yep. It's all you need to know. It's everything.
It's all about Sandy Ridge.
So come on by and see what basically amounts to a great yearbook right there.
It does.
Yeah. Lots of great pictures. Thanks, Nancy, and all those who, and Connie, who put this together.
Yes, I really appreciate Nancy and Connie. Yeah.
Well, thank you, Donna. So we'll put that, well, we have it on display afterwards so people can see it. We'll find some place to put it. It probably will not be on a bed, even though it's a quilt. So how we fold this thing. Let's do that right here. All right. And then I'd like to introduce a great group of people. And if you can, if you're physically able, I'd like for you to, after you get your certificate, I'd like for you to stand and keep standing. If you're not physically able to remain standing, that's fine. But I'd like for you to, if you can. And I need a couple runners. Brother Sean, would you help me? I know that you're in charge at the firehouse, and I feel dumb asking you. But anyways, I appreciate that. Brother Mike, you're a Marine. You should be able to run still. And so these are folks that have been members of Sandy Ridge Baptist Church since 1969 or earlier. So these are 50-year members. And we have 15 of them. And so Mary Matthews, would you stand? Is Mary Matthews in the building? There you are. Thank you. Take it right. And Joe Matthews is in the back. And we have one for both. Robinette Hedrick, is she in the room? There we are. Thank you. Let me give you the other one, too. Emery and Caroline Eller, if they're able. Diane Green. And if you're wondering, we let people join in their car seats back in the day. That's why, right? Yeah. Janice Granger. Bill Cole. Bill Boyette. Linda Tigg. Is Claude Harmon here this morning? All right, Claude Harmon also. Appreciate Claude, yes. David and Donna Houston. Is she here?
No, she wasn't.
Donna Klein. And then we have one for your mother, Lillian Caldwell. If you could take to her, that'd be really great. Thank you. Now, while you're standing, I just want to say to you, thank you. No question, in a church like this, a church our size, a church as long as we've been, you have had many opportunities to leave. And you found reason after reason to stay. And I thank God for you. As Jesus said in John chapter 4, I've sent you to labor where other people have worked. And that's the way I feel when I think about 15 church members that have been here 50 years or more. Thank God for you. You may be seated. Amen. Amen. All right, ushers, why don't you come and let's take up the offering. And I was hoping Brother Homer Green could be here this morning so that I could split my preaching time with him. And so you're going to hear from Brother Homer Green, if God is willing, right after this next song in our offering. Is that okay with you? Good. And then we'll go and eat some good groceries over in the other building. Don't forget, if you didn't bring anything, we want you to stay anyways. And I want to thank the Lord for all the work, the kitchen committee and the decorations committee and the 75th anniversary committee have all done. The audio and visual committee still working very hard all the time. And I thank God for you. And I hope that you'll stay and eat with us after the service. If you're not sure how to get to the food, probably follow the crowd, but you could go through either one of these doors, find the stairs. There's an elevator right over here, and find yourself over at one of the many hundreds of seats we have available for yourself around a table, and we'll have food line. Then tonight at 5:30, yes, our evening service usually starts at 6, but tonight at 5:30, we'll have special music from three different folks, right? We have, I don't know what order, but we have, who's at 5:30? Who's singing at 5:30?
The Evans family.
The Adams family. Who?
The Evans.
The Evans family. They'll be at 5:30. Wonderful. All right, and then who's at? And then who's at? Who's at?
Then the Calls, Andrew and Dana.
The Calls
and the kids
are at 5:45.
And then Keith, Kim, Cindy's group will sing.
At 6.
Yep.
Wonderful. And then we'll have a special speaker tonight, and we'll be out promptly by 7. All right. Let's have a word of prayer. My God, thank you for the great opportunity you've brought us here to enjoy this memory, this time of building memories, the fellowship one with the other. I want to give you thanks for loving us the way that you do. No one can love us the way that you do. We're so disappointed every time we try to find a suitor that is not you. I pray, oh Lord, that you'd continue to disappoint us as we chase idols so that we can continue to find our fulfillment in you alone. Oh Lord, glorify yourself through another year or two or 9 or 20 or 50 or 100 of this church. I pray that you'll be the star, you'll be the leading role, you'll be first fiddle in this church. I pray that you'll be the preacher that we hear the most every Sunday. I pray, oh Lord, that you be glorified in this offering, the music, and the preaching to follow. In Jesus' name, amen.
One day when heaven is filled with his praises, one day when sin was as black as could be, Jesus came forth to be born of a virgin, dwelt among men, my example is he. The Word became flesh and the light shined among us, his glory revealed. Living, he loved me. Dying, he saved me. Buried, he carried my sin far away. Rising, he justified freely forever. One day he's coming. Oh, glorious day, oh, glorious day. One day they led him up Calvary's mountain. One day they nailed him to die on a tree. Suffering, anguish, despised and rejected, bearing our sins, my Redeemer is he. The hand that held nations stretched out on a tree and took the nails for me. Living, he loved me. Dying, he saved me. Buried, he carried my sin far away. Rising, he justified freely forever. One day he's coming, oh glorious day, oh glorious day. Sunday. grave could not keep him from rising again. Living, he loved me. Dying, he saved me. Buried, he carried my sin far away. Rising, he justified freely forever. Freely forever. One day he's coming. Oh, glorious day. Oh, glorious day. Oh, glorious day. Oh, glorious day.
Will you pray with me? God, thank you. Thank you. We have a victory to celebrate this morning. What an incredible day it will be when we see you face to face. We thank you that you entrust with us the ministry, that you choose to use us in your work, and God, that you have the church established here at this corner. And you have the church established around the world to work together to sing of the good news of Jesus Christ and that glorious day. Be with us, God, as your word is brought forth. Thank you for men who are dedicated to being true and honest to what you have brought to us through the Bible. I thank you for Homer Green as he comes, just blessing God. Thank you for his ministry, his tireless giving of his body and self and heart to this church and this community. We pray all of this in Jesus Christ, our Savior's name. Amen.
I'm going to be reading from Jeremiah 32, verses 27 through 29. Behold, I am the Lord, the God of all flesh. Is there anything that is too hard for me? Therefore, thus saith the Lord, behold, I will give this city into the hand of the Chaldeans and into the hand of Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon, and he shall take it. And the Chaldeans shall fight against this city, shall come set it on fire and burn it with the houses upon whose roofs they have offered incense unto Baal, and poured out drink offerings unto other gods to provoke me to anger.
Thank you, Shannon. I have used some poetry prior to this time, and it still rings true. There's none on earth quite as good and great as God Himself. I've looked everywhere for men of renown and men of integrity. And as you know, they're very difficult to find. I come today to call your attention to an experience found by Dr. George W. Truett in Clay County in 1948. I know of a world that is sunken in shame, whose hearts are faint and tear. But I know a name, a precious name, that can give that world new birth. And you and I know who that name and that person is. Jesus Christ, the Son of the living God, always and ever, and we're grateful for that. The next segment is likewise written by Dr. R.C. Campbell, with the name with whom many of you are very, very familiar. The Library of Congress has a number 54-56-9282, and the copyright is by Fleming Revel and the company that is forward, and forward the introduction is given by R.G. Lee. He states, I knew R.C. Campbell for many, many years. I knew him to be, in those days, a man who would weigh between 6 ounces to the pound and measuring 36 inches to the yard in all matters that would make a Christian character. This godly man served his pastorate at some of the most distinguished places in Southern Baptist history. Now, a message to which I call your attention is on page 16. And I could wish to God that the reference is that Dr. Campbell started by stating that man has power, but his power is finite. Man's power is finite. God's power is infinite. And I have asked the question again and again, who knows what infinity is? Man can make a mountain out of what God created. God created a universe with all of its revolving planets. Man can make an artificial lake. God can sink oceans into thriving reefs. Man can make an electric light. God can make a billion blazing suns. God, man can make a canal, but God can make God can mark out a Mississippi River to wind its way to the Gulf of Mexico. Man can contrive or contrive a project. Only God can give power to where we are depending too much upon man's power today. I heard long ago Dr. A.C. Dixon say, when you depend upon an organization, you get what an organization can do. When you depend upon man, you get what man can do. When you depend upon prayer, you get what God can do. We need today in our churches throughout the land, including Sandy Ridge Baptist Church with its historic 75th anniversary, that which only God can do. And you and I can believe and trust in His mercy, wisdom, grace, and might, and believe that He can do it and that He will do it. Now then, the story to which I referred a few moments ago, to be sounded across the length and breadth of America and throughout the world, is simply this. In the story of George W. Truett's life, Palatine James, the historian of a Methodist camp meeting in Clay County, North Carolina. The meeting for him. Thank you, boys.
Okay, you'll sit down.
Yeah. I'm so delighted today that since God took my better half home, I have two angels that have stood by me. And I'm grateful for both of them. And I have some of the best caregivers in the country, and I thank God for each one of them. Well, Uncle Elijah Kinsey said that he made this statement: I have prayed all night that God will give me a message for this day, and I appear before you ministers this morning with a heart to preach God's word. I've come to you for this unusual purpose, that I may preach. They knew him and believed in him. All night he prayed that God would give him a message, and he did so in substance, and God gave him the preaching hours. They only had four: 8 o'clock a.m., 11:30 a.m., 8 o'clock p.m., and again at 8 o'clock p.m. They asked him which one would suit you best. And Uncle Elijah McKenzie said, the quicker the better. And they scheduled him for 8 o'clock. And he began to preach. And as he began to preach, the power of God fell upon that congregation, and nobody today knew exactly when that meeting closed. As he preached, lost men and women, boys and girls, fell out of the aisles, out of the pews into the aisles, begging for salvation, and God saved them. And that day, over 500 people were won to Jesus Christ. Wouldn't that be great if that could be said about Sandy Ridge Baptist Church on this day? Amen. I love you, and I know that you love me. And God bless you many, many times over. Amen. Thank you for the privilege. One of the greatest pastors in the country is William Jacob Stern. You know, I thought many times that I would go on before my wife said, and a lot of people thought the same thing. Stay back.
You may be seated.
All right, Vance, we're gonna do Glorious Day. We'll do verse one and a chorus, yeah, and then end it.
Yeah, we work.
Okay. So actually, Do you want them to stand or you want them to
stand? No, you know what? I think we're good right here. Okay. We'll just save it. Let's just sing the chorus. Want to?
Just one time through?
Yeah, let's just
to
do
the
one.
End.
Yeah.
Okay.
How about we just do it a cappella and make it easier
yes.
on you? Living, he loved me. Dying, he saved me. Buried, he carried my sins far away. Rising, he justified freely forever. One day he's coming, oh, glorious day, oh, glorious day. Amen. How about Luke chapter 9? I'll just close our time out here with some thoughts from Luke chapter number 9, please. And then we'll dismiss and enjoy some lunch. But I do want to give the Lord his rightful time. Pastor Green, thank you. I appreciate the good word from Jeremiah. I feel like I heard it from Jeremiah. It's a blessing to be able to visit you nearly every Lord's Day. And I thank God for you.
Thank you, Pastor.
Yes, sir. Luke chapter number 9, please. I'd like you to notice a passage we've read many times before. And the reality is I have many notes that I won't get to. That's okay. What I do want you to see is, well, it's typically because I over-prepare. But what I want you to see, please, this morning is the reality of a yet another truth in these verses that we've been on for weeks. I've had people say often, why do you go so slow through the Scripture? Because we're pretty slow about obeying it. And so I feel like when we see something, we ought to allow ourselves to be challenged by it. Take a look at verse 28. It came to pass about 8 days after these sayings that he took Peter, James, and John and James, and went up on the mountain to pray. And he prayed, and the appearance of his face was altered, and his robe became white and glistening. And behold, two men talked with him, who were Moses and Elijah, who appeared in glory and spoke of his decease, which he was about to accomplish. That was 2 weeks ago. Peter and those who were with him were heavy with sleep, and when they were fully awake, they saw his glory, two men who stood with him. It happened as they were parting from him that Peter said to Jesus, Master, it's good for us to be here. Let's make three tabernacles, one for you, one for Moses, one for Elijah, not knowing what he said. And while he was saying this, a cloud came and overshadowed them, and they were fearful as they entered the cloud, and a voice came out of the cloud saying, This is my beloved Son, hear him. The voice had ceased, Jesus was found alone, but they kept quiet and told no one in those days any of the things they had seen. After the service, I would ask you visitors who are interested in me knowing who you are, fill out a card and bring it to me right at the front. Say, I don't have time. Okay, bring it to me right at the front. And I'll swap it, a jar of this apple butter for your card. I'd like to get to know you. It's really important that you feel like you have a home here. I'm a nobody. But I'm thankful to be the pastor. But I know who I am, and I thank God for that. And I praise the Lord for this text right here. I want you to consider it with me. Peter is sleeping, but he's not fully asleep. How do I know that? Because it talks about him being fully awake. Where does it say that he was fully awake? Verse number 32. Peter and those with him were heavy with sleep. When they were fully awake, they saw his glory and the two men who stood with him. And look here. It happened as they were parting from him. So as Elijah and Moses were leaving the scene, Peter feels pressured. He's thinking, can such a moment just appear and disappear, come and go? And Peter thought, we must continue this moment. And so he says, let's build three tabernacles. Three tabernacles. That'll be just a moment, but if you get this, it'll help you. It'll help me. It has helped me. And Peter, I've been told here as before, he says, it is good for us to be here, verse 33. Let us make three tabernacles. He wants Peter, James, and John. Peter wants James and John to help him make three tents. Now, probably about 10% of you are right now not paying any attention. You're checking out the footnotes in your study Bibles. And it's probably saying to you something about the Feast of Tabernacles. And there's no reason to see the Feast of Tabernacles here for several reasons. Because of time, I won't go at it. I won't talk about it. But what is clear is that when Peter, James, and John, who are not fully awake, are hearing Jesus and Elijah and Moses in verse 31 discussing Jesus' decease, discussing Jesus' exodus, discussing Jesus' death, verse 31, which he was about to accomplish at Jerusalem. Okay, so get this. Peter, James, and John, Mount of Transfiguration, they're almost asleep. They're hearing discussion about Jesus' death. We've talked about this already. I won't belabor the point. But what we haven't talked about is Peter's desire to ask these two guys, Moses and Elijah, heroes, to stay behind. And so he hears this talk about Exodus. His mind goes back to the story of Moses, the exodus of the children of Israel out of Egypt. That's the Greek word behind decease in verse 31, exodus. So they hear Jesus and Moses and Elijah talking about the exodus. Jesus and Moses and Elijah have a lot in common. Jesus and Moses and Elijah all fasted for 40 days and 40 nights. Moses and Elijah both fasted for 40 days and 40 nights on Mount Sinai. Jesus went on the Mount of the Beatitudes and gave a law to his disciples after Moses went on to Mount Sinai and gave. There's a lot of similarities between these three people. And Peter wants them to have a tent, a home, a place to stay. And he remembers the story of the Old Testament. God would dwell in their midst in a tabernacle, and everyone else would pitch tents around it. So it was right and natural for Peter to think that if God is going to be among us, that he must have a tent. And that is true. We want God to have a place to dwell. We are thankful for this place that was built in 1978, I believe, dedicated in 1978. I still have the program from that day that Brother Benji gave me. This is a place where God can dwell. This is a wonderful place where he dwells among his people. And I want to quickly say, and not lose my train of thought, Peter wants to do what's right. As far as he's concerned, he wants to include his brothers in on this effort to get Jesus and Moses and Elijah to stay put with them. How many of you know that when heaven shows up in your midst, when you feel God's presence, you're not in a hurry to move on to anything else? And if you haven't had that, you need to linger with Jesus a little longer. Maybe Jesus and Folgers, depending on what time of day you meet with Jesus. But Jesus will be fine if you need Folgers, dark chocolate, whatever it is. Lots of dark chocolate. It's wonderful. It'll help you in your walk with the Lord. But as you're meeting with Jesus, you want him to have a place where he feels at home. See, when you come to church,